Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Handmade, Creative Focus in the Age of Distraction. By Gary Rogowski. Narrated by B.J. Harrison. Foreword. In the fall of 1989, I was newly married and sorely in need of a unifying piece of furniture. Having just moved to Portland, Oregon, I had no idea where to turn, so I asked a curator of a prominent local exhibit hall, who gave me three names, singling out one in particular for his unusual style. A week later, Gary Rogowski was at our door. My then wife and I had decided that our most important piece of furniture should be a dining room table, hopefully a spacious one, constructed flexibly enough that it could hold forth when needed, but fold up to take a more supplementary position when not needed. With that in mind, we had a photo of a classic dark wood gate leg table. You've probably seen the type, with hinged leaves that can fold down at the sides, partly covering the gathering of its legs. Gary looked at the photo for a long moment, then shook his head. "I don't like this," he finally said. "It looks like a bug." After we all shared a laugh, a sense of uncertainty set in. Sure, the table doesn't look like much when in its folded position, but that's not its prime time. More important, this is how gate leg tables are made. "Let me play with this for a few days," Gary said. "There has to be a better way to design a gate leg table." Before leaving, Gary said a few words about his preferred style, an eclectic mix he developed over the years that he called Oriental Deco. We had little idea what he meant, but the work we saw in his portfolio was clearly expert and gorgeous. So, we paid him to draw up some tentative designs and waited. Some weeks later, Gary brought back a scheme for a large oval table that had a clean, somewhat modernist beauty when opened, and then an entirely different beauty when closed. In some ways, in fact, it was particularly stunning when folded up. The down leaves, which formed most of the oval on each side, swooped toward the floor and up again, almost like a schooner. When the legs were folded up behind them, they formed a spare, geometric design that recalled the serenity of a traditional Japanese home. The combination, a few strong lines rounded out by a gentle curve, did indeed have a deco feel with an Oriental spirit. It has been nearly 30 years since Gary built this table, doing so incidentally only after mocking the whole thing up several times in cardboard, building it with stunning pieces of cherry wood, and hand-finishing it with round after round of elbow grease and his own proprietary series of wood oils. I have held on to this piece through a divorce, several moves, a remarriage, and the abuses of young children. To this day, anyone joining us for dinner remarks on the singularity of its design and the obvious quality of its workmanship. During those 30 years, I have also come to know Gary as a friend, a fellow writer, and a deep thinker about what craftsmanship means in a rushed, computerized world where our daily experiences seem to get more superficial every day, with little understanding of the complex ingredients that real quality requires. I have suspected that this book was coming for a long time. If the decades these ideas spent in gestation have been frustrating to the author, we are the beneficiaries of his struggles. The result is a wild ride, part autobiography, part philosophical manifesto, part search for meaning in a time when eternal values are up for grabs. In the process, Gary takes us through the myriad eclectic trails he explored to find his answers and achieve his own level of mastery. The terrain is endless, highly individualized, and of course, partly uncharted. But that's what made it worthwhile. Mastery, as you will soon discover, is not just a set of achievements or even a level of skill. It's a state of mind, observant, unafraid, focused, patient. Once you have the keys to such an attitude, which Gary strives to hand you herein, you can use them to unlock any number of doors. That is a great blessing for those of us hoping to become master woodworkers or masters of anything. Todd Oppenheimer, editor and publisher of Craftsmanship Quarterly, craftsmanship.net. Preface. Dear Gary, this note comes to you from the future. I am writing it years after you started to think about changing your life. It is, of course, one of the great mysteries and sureties of life that you can imagine the future, think you know its possibilities, and never be even close to getting it right. I have penned this book for you and for others like you. For those who are considering a life of creating, these words will show how choices can resonate through a lifetime, that small things can influence in big ways, and that it is an intentional decision to build a life as an artist in this culture. It has consequence. It can be an act of forgiveness as well as one of creation. Do good work. Sincerely, Gary. Preamble. I am one of the loudest woodworkers there is. Don't think for a second that my 40-plus years at the bench building furniture has transformed my nature. I am given to swearing at myself and my mistakes loudly enough that God can hear me without his ear trumpet. I am persnickety to exasperation with myself, with my obsession for precision, and like some player in a Greek tragedy, I am chained to this rock forever. I can be stunned into silence some days by the new problems I create for myself at the bench. I should know better, and yet I act shocked by each new error, the most recent design flaw, a fantastic misplacement of tool or mortise. It may surprise you, then, that my stumbling, erring ways allow me to produce any work at all. Yet somehow, I have managed to make some very good things. I have worked at creating a life, building furniture, which is a hard thing to do anywhere, and I have lasted at it. Handmade furniture is not a need, it is a desire. Those of us who try to make a living at it are stubborn, focused, and ill-suited for polite office company and its politics. We love tools and wood, and to solve problems. We love wearing many hats, taking on all sorts of roles throughout a job. Finally, and most importantly, we love to talk to ourselves. We need to have this running dialogue, this duet of yin and yang, our left brain logic fighting our right brain shenanigans. It is a delicate balance between determination and caution based on our past failures. It is also important for us to be at the bench, for that is where the voice is quiet, where the healing begins. My story is not about building furniture. Building furniture is simply a metaphor. My story is about practice and forgiveness. I do not claim to be the best woodworker in the world. I can design and build well, and I can write. To put it more simply, I can walk and chew gum at the same time. One came naturally, and the other took years of training. But I can walk and chew gum now, at least. After some decades of building furniture, I penned 2 books on joinery and wrote for several magazines. Along the way, I started a school for woodworkers, the Northwest Woodworking Studio, located in Portland, Oregon, a climate well-suited for work indoors at the bench. This is where I have taught and inspired folks about this craft. Over this time, I have also learned how to forgive myself my errors, how to fix most of my mistakes, and how not to point out the flaws in my work. I have learned when and how to pick up the pace. I have gained a fluency in my hands with my tools. I can make things look simple at the bench and amaze my students with the ease of my movements. I can perform a task in minutes that for them can take an hour. I am a master at woodworking. It is no contradiction. Just as a writer or composer struggles with his or her own demons in writing a story or song, one always brings one's quirks, one's habits, one's tics to the task of creating. The problem at the bench isn't the work, the challenges, or the mistakes. It was always me. People assume that mastery of any type is a place that one reaches. It is a glow in the air that starts to become visible and hover around you. Or it is a corner that one turns on some fantastic day. These are pretty fantasies, pictures, showpieces, background images fit for a movie about a bygone era. Mastery of anything is an accumulation of experiences that, if you have a brain instead of rocks in your head, points out to you the truth of these things. You will get old, you can learn from your mistakes, and you should help others to their own truth. The things that you make will also accumulate and survive you. Do your best with each job. There will be evidence. If you work with your hands, I know who you are. If you have the desire to create and to make things, I am just like you. Let me tell you a story. Education works. Few of us have any idea where our choices will put us, how the twists and turns in our lives will place us on paths we never imagined. I came to the West Coast in the 1970s to study literature at a small school called Reed College. I had left the Midwest, where I had grown up in the fields outside of Chicago, flat, steadfast, and certain, me in the fields. For my last 2 years of school, I had transferred from a Midwestern university large enough to swallow a town inside its geography, the University of Illinois, with its 30,000 students. I came to Reed with its 1,500 intellectuals. I came without visiting, without knowing anyone, without ever having been to the West Coast. I was bored with my life. I needed to remake myself away from my past, my friends, and my history, as if we can ever leave all these behind. They come with us, of course, in those tattered memory suitcases that we all carry around. The past, our traces, our lineage in time. Reed was a small college, intellectually challenging, yet oddly incestuous. I say of it that I hated my 2 years there. I wish I had spent four. The students there stayed in this tempest, not venturing much into the city beyond, convinced of their intelligence and righteous in their arrogance. It was a place where one had to defend any idea, any statement, no matter one's state of sobriety. Priming myself there for a long life as a writer and teacher, I studied the great books. I tried and failed, as we all do, to grasp the idea of time slipping through my hands. 25 years later, still living in Portland, I attended a reunion event at the college. I came upon an old professor of mine there. As a literature major, I had enrolled in a class on the Victorians with the signature black sheep of the faculty at the time, Jim Webb. He was a badass with a capital B, nicknamed Spider God. He had the gaunt look of a smoker and drug addict made so popular by the Rolling Stones. Mostly dressed in black, always wearing colored sunglasses indoors, he presented an image not quite in keeping with standard academia decorum. If not hated by the administration, he was not popular with them for many things. His dress, his demeanor, certainly his attitude towards their authority and disdain for their methods of education. He was not popular for his stand on hiring a new college president. He had rented a billboard and plastered it with the face of the current college president, asking, would you buy a used college from this man? In a campus of outliers, he was the furthest out. For his class on the Victorians, we had started round a table in familiar Elliott Hall on campus, like most of my lit classes. We moved out to his house near campus to have our sessions soon after our first class. To convene elsewhere was a shocking enough concept then. A class not held in the confines of school? As if bricks could contain this man's ideas. The house itself stood as a nondescript small Tudor, but inside, the walls were painted black, the windows draped in black curtains. This made it seem that his class was more risky, more real, and we, the students who had entered this world, had it going on. Yeah, man. We studied the mystics, such as Blake, Rossetti, and others like Ruskin. As in most literature classes at my college, discussions were replete with argument, logical discourse, and both ascendant and conquered positions. Our leader was, by his nature, very appealing to college-age students, mysterious, intense, very smart, and just a little bit crazy, it seemed. One time in class debate, I happened to cite the book we were reading as the proof of my cause. Making my point, whatever it might have been, I said, "It was there in the book." Jim Webb skewered me with this question. "You believe what you read in books?" My opponent in the debate chuckled at my naivete. Ouch. It was no place for intellectual wimps. Defend your position. Webb also wanted us, in our Victorian literature class, to get wood lathes and to put these tools on his porch and start making wooden bowls and things, just like Morris and Ruskin might have done. He lauded this approach of mingling literature and the crafts, melding mind and body. At the time, I scoffed at the thought. I imagined myself as a thinker, a writer, not a bowl turner. When I saw him at that reunion, he sat on the ground under one of the giant beech trees near the commons where people congregated. It was a rare sunny day in June. He was sitting cross-legged, spread out on a blanket, happy it seemed, and wearing his characteristic enigmatic smile, his tinted glasses, and a cigarette. He was selling beads and things from his New Mexico hideaway, where he raised goats and who knew what else. Peyote, probably, if he only asked for it. I saw him there, and I immediately walked up to him. I introduced myself and said, "I took your Victorian literature class back in 1971, when you said you wanted to put lathes on the porch so we could turn bowls. I thought it was the most effed up idea I had ever heard." I paused. He was quiet. He looked up at me. "I'm a woodworker now." He jumped up into the air off his blanket and held up his arms and yelled, "Education works!" Nice moment. Beliefs. It is my belief that working with our hands is valuable. Connecting with tools to create things offers us a compensation that no electronic calculus can bring. The cacophony that is the internet keeps us distracted, impatient, anonymous, and searching, but rarely satisfied. When we can see the results of our labor, paring with a chisel, using the needle and thread, creating with paintbrush, soldering gun, or pen in hand, there is a different sense of accomplishment. It is a needed blessing in a hurried world to be able to say at the end of a long day, "I did this. Here are the results." It may only be an attempt to create something that feels solid in a world of impermanence. But this kind of progress means something to me in a day, perhaps to you as well. I have named this first section the preamble. This is the stretch before we start our walk, which seems like a good way to begin a journey. It will give you a sense of what you're about to find here. This is the story of a life given to a craft. I call it memoirable, because it talks a bit about how I got here. It is also a discourse on the philosophy of quality in a life. With the impetus provided by Robert Pirsig to the musings of Sotsu Yanagi, Twyla Tharp, Ted Kooser, and others, this book is a pronounced statement about the value of quality in today's world. It is written to others as the century has turned and is headed faster than ever for uncharted territory. I believe in the value of quality for the maker, the artist, and for the recipient. There is a resonance felt by all who come into contact with it. This idea swims into a cultural current that is strongly set against it, where quality is currently more of a shapeshifter and less a beacon to steer by. The word is used now as a branding strategy, recalling an imagined better day gone by. Yet I believe that quality has value in the life of the maker, for what he or she does to create, and for the recipients and users of this work. There is quality in the making. This is a book that trumpets the value of failure in an education, that posits that no one has life all figured out, particularly those who tell you that they do, and that if you aren't having fun by doing your work, you kill a part of yourself by doing so. Finally, as in most lives, the longer one hangs around, the more stories one can tell that can teach, make us laugh, and help illuminate ideas. My own story is about stumbling onto the right path and staying on it. It is about the value of committing to an art and practicing skills every day until I got it in my bones. I simply propose that this can be your journey as well, even if you never touch a piece of wood but paint or sculpt clay or words instead. The struggle of the artist remains the same. You are not alone. We are still humans for all our digitizing of the world. Our needs, our desires remain the same. We need to use our hands. We love to create. We can become very skilled. How we do this is both personal and universal. When we build, let us think that we build forever. John Ruskin. Act 1. Discovery and Surprise. 1. The Smell of Sawdust. I was no woodworker as a youth. It never entered my mind. Grandpa was a carpenter, a coal miner, a bartender. We called him Jads. He lived with us for a time between jobs or wives. His first wife died. His second left him. I adored him because he always treated me with a mixture of great love and caution. Maybe he was afraid he would break me if he held me too hard with his iron grip. When I was small, I remember him pointing out the western sun one dusk and telling me how it would move in the sky through the seasons. What other secrets did he know? He could move anything with his pry bar, hammer, and shovel. He found work where he could, like any immigrant in the early 20th century. He always worked with his hands. I couldn't help but see that one thumb of his was as wide as three of mine. He must have hit it with a hammer so many times that it just spread out in submission. Or maybe he nailed it just once really hard when he was drunk. Didn't he notice where he was putting it? I remember him working at our farmhouse in Illinois for a time. He had built the saltbox-style house on farmland outside of Chicago, finding this small parcel on his way to go fishing at Lake Geneva. My family had moved from the city and taken it over from him when I was small. It was all country then, flat fields, dotted with a few homes huddled together every few dozen acres, so the tornadoes would have easier targets to blow down. There was always something for him to fix there, more carpentry needed for the house, or a chore for my dad. As As a young teenager, I wasn't concerned with celestial movement, but in keeping up with other kids. One day I was lifting weights behind the house on our concrete patio, trying to get as strong as my older brother. I was out in the sunshine grunting with an iron bar. Jads saw me and smiled. He walked past me, over to where he had been working. He reached down to the ground and grabbed a 4x4 timber. He walked back to me, holding it by its end in one of his hands, and said, "Lift this." Good guy. Polish sense of humor. My father was a more than capable handyman. He knew tools and how to use them. He could mix and pour concrete, do electrical work. He transformed the old attached garage on our house into a living room. He made furniture for the new church. He built me a desk to study at. My brother and I did a list of chores for him around the house. We were also enlisted to carry his tools to fix the tractor, or to hold the light as he fixed the sump pump in the basement. He was always yelling at me for something, or he would throw his tools down in disgust and scream at me for not paying attention to what he was doing. "Hold the ladder still, dummy!" It was easy to hate being around him working on things. If I complained, one of his favorite sayings to me as I grew older and could understand its significance was this bit of homespun warmth. "You know where you can find sympathy? Between shit and syphilis in the dictionary." As my friend Vinny used to say about people, he was a piece of work. My dad, I realized later, was a 3-year-old in the body of an abusive alcoholic. He could erupt over how someone passed the food, spitting, sputtering, furious with the transgression. It's not how to act, and yet this is what we learn to expect, the exploding father. He constantly proved that he could control the room with his anger. Maybe he learned it from his father, although I never saw that type of anger from Jad's. Maybe he learned it in World War II, or from the failures in his own life. It's no way to act, except maybe in battle, screaming your needs, your disappointments, your standards to the person across the table. He, of course, had standards for me and my brother. His standards were simple and impossible to reach. Nothing we did was ever good enough. Do it better. My mother couldn't stand up to him, and my brother tried to follow his example of disdain toward me, just without the surprise explosions. Not surprisingly, I tended to shrink inside myself a bit. I developed an interior world to live within. I don't remember having any interest in how furniture was made. At that time, I was more interested in throwing paper balls at the trash can than wondering how my father had built my desk. I sat at it doing homework, studying to avoid his belt, or worse, the verbal abuse. Punishment is quite an interesting mentor to a kid. I have been asked by many people over the years, "Did you take shop class as a kid?" My response is, yes. I didn't like it. I remember that my required talk in sixth grade shop class, replete with visuals, was on wood screws. I do not remember being fascinated by my lecture. My mahogany bookends for class were nailed together and had the hasty grace of all my work then. It never occurred to me growing up that building furniture could be a choice in life, that being at the bench could be an act of forgiveness for me, as much as a career choice. Even through all this, one of my great remembered experiences of when I was little was being shooed out of our kitchen when the cabinet maker came to build our new cabinets. He set up his sawhorses outside our house and cut up fir and plywood on them to make our cabinets, producing piles of sawdust and shavings that filled the air with the smells of his handiwork. I was entranced by the fragrance of the wood. Somehow, being around it made me feel good. What he was building made no difference to me. I loved the smell of that wood. Going to the lumber yard with my dad was also a thrill, because the warehouse was mysterious. Who knew what happened here? And cavernous. It was a cathedral to a small kid, with its tall, dim roof. Only it was better than church because you didn't have to be quiet in there. Boards rose up into the dark insides of this timbered building, and there was that resiny aroma again, wrapping its charm around me. I could walk around with my dad, which, even for all his yelling at me, always made me feel special when I was small. I could look at all the lumber and smell the wood. Sawdust smells like nothing else. I did not know until years later how hooked I was by this experience, how intoxicating this was to me at the time. I forgot about it. I was a thinker, a dreamer, lost in my books and scribblings as I grew up. I wasn't going to work with my hands. I was going to get as far away from the world of my father as I could. Whatever he stood for, I would stand elsewhere. I was going to be a teacher of some kind, maybe a priest or a scribe or a writer. And so I went to a college to study literature and the great books. People ask, how did you become a woodworker then? My reply was simple. It was the scientists. They showed me the way. Things men have made with wakened hands and put soft life into are awake through years with transferred touch and go on glowing for long years. And for this reason, some old things are lovely, warm still with the life of forgotten men who made them. D.H. Lawrence. Abner Ridge. One of the scientists I knew at college was a physics major, Dick Wheaton. He was a motorcycle guy, a motorhead who loved fixing things, and an avid outdoorsman. He was a bit taller than me, just over 6 feet, and thin, with large, wire-rimmed glasses. He seemed imperturbable and was always happy facing a problem. His laugh ended on a high note, even when laughing at himself. When I moved to the Pacific Northwest to finish up college, I started hiking and rock climbing in the Cascades with Wheaton. These mountains, with their carpets of fir and hemlock, have a flavor, a sense, a feeling about them that is suited for contemplation. Hiking in the woods became wrapped up in my life as a woodworker. I never walked alone in these woods. There was always a throng of thoughts marching alongside me in my head, chattering away. These fragments and ideas, minor revelations and important discoveries, and thoughts about what a life should look like, all strolled with me as I took in the sights and sounds. Walking was a way of both clearing and filling my brain at one and the same time. I needed this movement to break ideas loose inside me, to stir things up, and to let thoughts settle. Being on a trail, seeing the mist weaving fingers through the tall firs, watching these close clouds rise up off hillsides through the dark canyons, seeing the rocks and treetops, these sights drew me to pathways where I could let my mind wander. In Robert McFarlane's lyrical book, The Old Ways, his story is about the concept of the path, the need we humans have for the journey. It is the walk itself, with its effort, its sacrifice, its tedium, or danger that is important, because in the walking, we get closer to the truths we hold inside ourselves. My own path to mastery is one taken by many others before me, but like any path, my footsteps make their own mark upon it. So too did these words of Thomas Clark from his famous poem, In Praise of Walking, suit me. In the course of a walk, we usually find out something about our companion, and this is true even when we travel alone. When I spend a day talking, I feel exhausted. When I spend it walking, I am pleasantly tired. The pace of the walk will determine the number and variety of things to be encountered, from the broad outlines of a mountain range to a tit's nest among the lichen, and the quality of attention that will be brought to bear upon them. Some things in nature have made a lasting impression on me: rivers, waterfalls, mountains. One such location was a particular trail in the Cascade Mountains that I found with Wheaton, Abner Ridge, a place in the forest that seemed to call me back over time. Wheaton and I, with my dog Joe Willie and two other hikers whose names are lost in memory, went for a hike up the Abner Ridge Trail. We went up at one spring to scale the western face of the mountain as high as we could reach, because someone had told us we could get pretty far up this way. We were young and energetic, with our new ice axes in hand, and we thought we could climb up the mountain anywhere. I do not remember the hike. Was it long or short? What did we see along the way? Had Wheaton's hands recovered enough from his accident to be trustworthy? We drove into the Cascade Range on the west side of the mountain to a place called Daisy Plain. From there, we walked in 3 or 4 miles to Klickitat Falls on a flat trail that was never straight but not hard walking. The falls were pretty enough that I wanted to stop and stare at them for a long time. There's a lot of worn ground there. Many feet have walked around these blue rivulets that tumble down a series of short rock falls, water rushing in a calm fountain of blue and noise, all hurrying down the rocks in the middle of the forest. It's glorious. But we had a hike to make, a mountain to climb, and needed to get moving. We'll see it again on the way back, I thought to myself. From the falls, we hiked 4 miles up a trail that was so long there were only 3 switchbacks in a 2,000-foot elevation gain. It was unmarked on my USGS map, but it started from the falls and headed up the long spine of Abner Ridge to the wilderness area. I put pencil marks on my map to indicate where we walked, because on my map there was no trail marked out, not this Abner Ridge trail. I don't remember the walk being long or boring or inspiring. I remember only being up top at the tree line where the trees cannot grow any higher up the mountain. It was cloudy out, so there wasn't much to see. Occasionally the mountain would peek out at us from above. The trail had disappeared, so we wandered around looking for a way up. We hadn't hit much snow yet, only a few patches. What we had run into, finally, were rocks. The humans could scale them with some effort, but not Joe Willie. We could push him up a few rock faces, but it was going to be tough getting him down. Even an able-bodied Brittany Spaniel like him could not climb here. We tried one section and another. They were all too sheer for him to leap, so we said, "That's enough." I marked my map to record where we had been, going off trail like we had. I thought I would be back soon. When I was young, I thought I'd get back to everywhere soon to retrace my steps. What could life possibly throw in the way? So we gave up our ascent and tried glissading down some icy patches of snow using our ice axes as brakes. We ran along the snow and then jumped onto our backs to slide downhill and practiced the arrest of our fall with our axes. Wheaton managed a descent arrest with his axe. With my first go at it, I stuck my landing and hit the icy snow so hard I felt like I had broken a rib. Maybe I did. I could barely breathe without pain, so I stopped my axe practice right there. It was one of several accidents that seemed to walk with us on this hike. We returned, me gasping for breath the whole way home. There, my memory of the hike stops. And on my map still are those pencil lines indicating where I thought we had gotten to. On the map, right at its edge, before it disappears into the whiteness of where the next map would begin, it says, "View." 2. The Scientists. My first year at college in Portland, I found a house to share with 4 others in the northeast section of town, miles from campus. One housemate, Bill, was a physics literature major, wrestling with two dissimilar worlds. He had physicist classmates over one afternoon to drink beer. I saw immediately that they thought about the world in an unusual way. My own knowledge of physics began and ended with my deep understanding that the sun is in the sky and it is made up of atoms that are hot. What else did I need to know? I was fascinated by how these scientists could talk for hours about the universe as a giant, whirling mass of gases, and then have a different discussion about atoms smashing into each other, or galaxies expanding or collapsing. They seemed to talk like they had some knowledge of how the world actually worked. They knew about gravity and astronomy, particle physics, like Babush, the Russian theoretician, death to the Bolsheviks, and Petros, the suave Greek lover. They knew about solar systems, galactic black holes, and motorcycles, like Joel the astronomer and Wheaton the motorhead, or how to fix a motorbike that I had dumped. I'm still sorry, Joel. And if they really did not know, then they sure talked a good game, with real joy and interest in the subject. I was very curious about how they approached things. Their chatter was so different from my own. It had nothing whatsoever to do with foreshadowing or imagery or metaphor. Of all the disciplines practiced in my halls of learning, the people with whom I felt the most affinity walked the halls of the physics labs. One night, four or five of us had gone out to Pine Mountain to view the moonrise. This was a small mountaintop about an hour outside of town, up a river gorge. The physicists knew the full moon was upon us that clear night, so we headed out to drink some beer and smoke and discuss important things. We walked out to a promontory, climbed over the outlook's fence, and onto the rocks, staring east toward the mountain and the moonrise. In the course of that night, as we started to shiver, the active brains of the physicists took over in a feat of phenomenal mental calisthenics. One of them asked if it was possible for pea to freeze before it hit the ground. More importantly, could it pull the perpetrating pisser over? Hilarious and stupid all at once, but the argument went on about temperature and molecules and ammonia content in all seriousness for them. I jotted this night down in my memory as I stared at the full moon, wondering about these guys. These were not small questions for them. This was physics. I was fascinated. Physicists were always asking, "What would happen if I did this?" But the weather was not severe enough to test anyone's theory, so there was no agreed-upon conclusion. I realized then that there was another way of being in the world. I was an intellectual of sorts when I graduated, halfway pregnant with possibility, my wry adage, and I thought I could do almost anything well. But really, my years of schooling had left me prepared to write pages on almost any literary subject without saying anything much of value. I was ready to accept a Pulitzer Prize for my novel yet to be written. In truth, I was lost. I was done with schooling, but had nothing to take its place. All I had known was reading, discourse, ennui. I bummed around Portland that summer, picking up odd jobs and drinking quarts of beer in the park with other bums like myself, trying to find something that sparked me, anything to spark me. I read some books that started to push me about what personal philosophy might look like. What kind of world could I create for myself? I read John Muir's amusing and folksy treatise on mechanics, How to Keep Your Volkswagen Alive, a manual of step-by-step procedures for the complete idiot. I also picked up the seminal book for my time, Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance, by Robert Pirsig. I began to think that maybe one could be a philosopher and still wear overalls, do real work, get your hands dirty, and yet still be thoughtful. This was a completely different worldview, where physical labor was not demeaning, where one could think about stuff like cause and effect while working with your hands, where one didn't have to look like an intellectual and have initials behind your name in order to be one. I had listened to my scientists discuss their cryptic ideas. I poured these closely watched things into my own beaker of philosophy that I carried around with me, the one filled with ideas about beauty and art and nonconformity. I snapped then to a kind of attention about my own life. Mine had been mapped out by my own sense of fear, by my own former impulse to conform, to do the right thing, and make the right choice in an attempt to please the authority figures in my life. I knew now that this was an impossibility, since my father was rarely happy with my results. Same with that religion I had once so keenly adhered to. No pleasing that God. We were already born stained. How can I be guilty before I did anything? While perfectionism might be ingrained in me, I could turn it onto a new path and try something completely out of the mainstream that I had been raised to wade into. I moved into a drafty 2-story tall house that was tucked back into some trees out of sight of the neighbors. There was a rutted, potholed road to it, grandly called a drive, and another gravel road called a court. I drove on through a stand of trees, disappearing into the woods. Across from the house, there was a spot that had been carved out into the blackberry patch, our garden, our retreat into nature. I went out there one night to sleep under the summer stars, and a barefaced possum and I scared the crap out of each other when we both walked into that patch together. The place had a nice feel to it, and the house was a grand place to be driftless. Room outside to sleep on your sleeping bag or tuck in on a couch. There was a large, old clawfoot tub in the bathroom to bathe in. The band, of course there was a band, practiced downstairs, and we lived in this dilapidation, surrounded by nature and hidden from prying eyes, so that one could think grand thoughts undisturbed. Perfect. One day, exploring around the side of the house, I found two things that intrigued me. One was an old wooden hand plane, and the other a piece of wood. The plane had metal fittings and a blade fixed into a long wood body. I didn't know it at the time, but it turned out to be a transition-style jack plane. The wood was cracked, and the fittings were rusted. It said something to me, murmuring a potential of some sort. This was the kind of tool I saw in the hands of the cabinet maker when I was young. The other thing I found nearby was a half-round chunk of wood that had fallen off the outside of a log some time ago. Its bark was off, and its outer surface was smooth, while the inside was scooped out like the round of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.